we received today, we are pleased to receive today Olivier Hamant. He's coming from Lyon for us. I think he's, I mean, his talk is really interesting because it provides a very different view of topics you are used to hear about. We'll talk about robustness. His field is biology. He's not a social scientist, but he's trying to think how what he sees in biology can help also us to maybe to think another pathway for our societies. So thank you very much, Olivier. You have an hour,
all right,
not more. Then we have the discussant, and thank
perfect.
You.
Thank you, David. Thank you for being here. It's a pleasure to be here. So indeed, I'll talk about robustness, and indeed about the larger society coming from the biology. So I'll just say a few words about me. So I'm a researcher. I work on plant biology. I'm not going to talk about my research project, which is really just basic science in plant biology. I'm here rather with my the cap of the Institut Michel Serres, the Michel Serres Institute. So I don't know if you know Michel Serres is a philosopher who's worked a lot on techniques and the humanity and nature interactions, let's say, the natural contract, for instance, in 1990. That's one of his books. So yeah, there's some inspiration in there. And so that's more like the drive for this talk today. Okay, so I'm going to start with just a very brief overview of the situation, if you want, or the current situation. But super bright. So it's pretty obvious that the one of the key markers of our society today is control and optimization. We are pushing control to a really high level, and we optimize everything. So the world is optimized, and it's becoming more optimizable. So it's really optimization is a key aspect of our society. So here I take the district of Lyon, but you can take any districts, even this one. It's the same. So we optimize structures, human structure, mind-made structures, but also we optimize life. So if you think of agriculture and the most recent development in agriculture, so this is a chicken breeding company, let's say. And so we optimize animals, we optimize plants. So we optimize everything. And even the landscape, right? So you just have to go outside and you see that everything is optimized, even things that we think are a bit far away from cities and humans. And so what's the problem with that, right? And so I think I'm going to start with this. We need to be clear on what we talk about, and is optimization such a great idea? So here I'm defining performance, because you can think of optimization as an increase of performance. When you increase performance, you optimize. Defining performance as the sum of efficacy and efficiency. Efficacy reaching one's goal, and efficiency with the least amount of means possible. If we agree on this definition of performance, it's a very standard definition of performance. In management, for instance, that's the definition of performance. And so when you optimize, you want to increase performance. And we are in this era of performance increments. So why is it a problem? So I'm going to give you a few keys to have a critique of performance. And so the first one is that when you control, when you optimize, when you increase performance, it's always in a reductionistic framework. You have large problems, you reduce the problem to a small problem, and then you target that problem and you solve that problem. If you solve that problem, you're going to generate many problems elsewhere. So it's a little bit like this. So the world is full of threads, different colors, different textures. And we just want to put that thread into that eye of a needle. And we think that when we do this, if we solve every problem one after the other, we'll solve all the problems of the world. Of course, this is a misconception. It's way too simplistic. There are a lot more interactions. So I can give you I can give you an example that is a bit controversial. Sustainable developmental goals, sustainable SDGs, right? So you know this, right? 17 SDGs, very politically correct. We all want no poverty, clean water. I mean, all this is very, very positive. But by design, SDGs they're designed to fail. They're designed to fail, because if you have 17 different objectives, they are going to be in competition with one another. You will want to be very performant, very efficient, very efficacious for one goal, And by doing this, you will prevent overgrowth from happening. So by design, it's not going to work. Actually, it is not working, SDG. And actually, just one small remark, SDG 8, economic growth, that's already a killer for the SDGs. So anyway, so this is an example where we see that performance does not work because it generates competition. But for the reductionism, you can take any example from the media, just listen to the news. Every day you see example of over-optimization. We are in an over-optimized world. And when you optimize, you weaken. So if you see the word optimized somewhere, the first thing you need to think about is what is becoming weaker. When you optimize something, you make something else weaker. And so here I take the example of the Suez Canal with this boat. So you have a large boat that is optimized for transport of goods in the Suez Canal, which is optimized to have the shortest path. So it's an efficient way to transport, right? So it's a shorter path. You put them together and then you block transport for a week or two because that boat is in the wrong direction. So this is a classic, but there are many, many other examples. You can take automatic tramway. I mean, you can many things, right? So every day there's something else. So it's very easy to see. So if we agree on this, optimization is not working, just to be clear. It weakens the system. Second thing is the rebound effect. And so this is also a very classic. This has been known since the 19th century, at least, the Jevons paradox on coal, for instance. But here you can take examples from the current era, let's say. So here, if you think of fridges, for instance, so fridges in the 60s, there were not too many fridges and they were not very energy efficient. We've made a lot of progress for the energy efficiency of fridges. So now we have fridges that are much, much more efficient. But what happens? They're cheaper. They are more attractive, so we buy more fridges. We buy wine cellars, air condition. I mean, all this is because it's more energy efficient. So when you increase energy efficiency by unit, it's more energy efficient, but the global consumption of resources is increasing. So this is a typical direct rebound effect. And so that means that energy efficiency does not work as well. It's too reductionistic. It's too simplistic. So this is for fridge, but this is true for everything, right? There are rebound effects not only for energy. So here I'm giving you a few examples of a rebound effect in many, many other sectors. So you can think of detergents. That's a very classic one. So if you have concentrated detergents, so here they say that you can wash 28 times, but of course you're going to use more. So what you're going to do is to pollute more. You're not going to wash more, you're going to pollute more. Oil palm, that's another example. So with oil palm, you know, oil palm is a very high yielding plant. It's really producing a lot of oil. And so it was thought in the beginning to be a plant that would prevent deforestation. Because if you put plants that have a higher yield, then you don't need to deforest because per square meter, you have more biomass that is produced. But actually what happens is when you do this, you create new needs for food, new needs for biofuels, and then you deforest more. So that's also a rebound effect. The digital world, so I can ask you the question, how many times do you enter a password every day? You know? So it's between 8 and 20 times. Yeah, for a computer user. I'm sure you're all computer users. So 8 and 20 times per day. And now with the double authentication, we'll do even more of that. And so the digital world that was supposed to make our life simpler is making our life even more complex, right? So now to write something, you need to have an app, you need to scan a QR code and everything. And the frugal technologies, that's another one. So the 5G antenna, for instance, so it's a smaller antenna. So it's sold as a frugal technology because it's consuming less resources. But of course, with 5G, so you have to put more antennas and you're going to fuel the field of connected objects. So the rebound effect is major and this is not going to be a frugal technology. Actually, it's not sustainable. So just rebound effect again, when you see something that says efficient, think of rebound effect. Third one is Goodhart law. So I'm trying really to give you some keys to kill performance, as you can tell. So the third one is Goodhart law. So this is this sentence. So when a measure becomes a target, it ceases to be a good measure. It's not reliable anymore. And so here I take the example of competition in sport. right? So when you do competition in sport, the goal is to have the higher score. And you'll do anything to get the higher score. So that means doping, going against your mental health, burnout. So there's the example of Marco Pantani, who died when he was 34. He got the doping and he also got a depression. So he has the combination of both. But with sport, there's also a lot of money laundering. And of course, with the Qatar, you also saw that now we do sports in region where we shouldn't do this kind of sports with the air condition in outside air. So, I mean, it's very clear, right? So the minute you have competition, the minute you want to perform, you're going to do everything to perform and you're going to lose why you do the performance. So this is for sport. It's like the rebound effect. It's true for many other things. So yeah, I just take the example of education. So if you want to perform in an education environment, whether it's a school or your university, so you'll do this, right? You'll cram for your exams. And by doing this, you will not learn. You will just get your exam, but not you will not get education. And the same thing goes for the Shanghai ranking of world universities. So you know there is this ranking of world universities every year. And so yeah, I take the example of Paris-Saclay. That is a new university that has been built. One of the reasons to build this new university is to have a major university in France that would reach the top 20. So it is indeed in the top 20. But the price to pay for this is an artificialization of land and the best land in the country. So you see the counterproductive effect, right? So you're going to, and exactly, so it's really it's a terrible choice. And in terms of, for the symbol, can you imagine you're going to educate, you're going to train the next generation of leaders, French leaders, on a land that you've lost. So that's the counterproductivity of the Goodhart law. But see, it's true for really many things. Yeah. Okay, and the fourth one, of course, and this is the one I'm going to insist the most, is that all our performance, so when we humans are performing, someone else is paying the price for our performance. And the someone else, these are the ecosystems, basically. The ecosystems are paying the price of our performance. So these are the four subjects, but I think you're quite aware of this. So I'm not going to insist on this. I think you're well aware of the ecological crisis. But there are four subjects. So it's not only the climate crisis, it's the resource scarcity. So for non-renewable, but also for renewable. Eh? So it's resource scarcity for all resources. Climate crisis, biodiversity collapse, and global pollutions. But again, I don't think I need to say much more than that, right? You've already been... Well, okay, so I'm not going to insist. It's just it's a really strong subject. The one, maybe the only keyword I want you to have when you see this, if you read the IPCC reports, IPBS and all these reports, the only thing that is in common is that the world is going to fluctuate. Fluctuation is the keyword. We are going to enter the era of turbulence, climate turbulence, chemical turbulence, biodiversity turbulence, I mean, all turbulence, social turbulence, geopolitical turbulence. So it's really the era of fluctuation. We are leaving the stable world. We are entering the unstable world. That's the only thing, to me, that's the most important thing to know from all these scientific reports. Okay, so as I said, I'm not going to go into the detail. Oops. So when we see this socio-ecological crisis, usually we are offered two options that are dominating, let's say, in the media or in education: sustainable development or degrowth, to say it in a different way. Right? So these are like the type, I mean, it's of course more complex than this, but the two types, let's say, of solutions are within this realm. So for sustainable development, there are some really interesting projects, some really well thought through projects. But there are also some projects that are really counterproductive. And so yeah, I take one, that's my favorite one. So here you see Joe Biden with the head of the car industry in the US. And you see two wonderful SUV, electric SUV in the background with a green grass, absolutely zero biodiversity. So that's really, that's what I call the strike of counterproductive sustainable development, right? That's a typical example where it's greenwashing, and it's better not to do anything than to do this, right? There's nothing sustainable about it. So that's sustainable development that is really counterproductive. So when you see this, you're just like, okay, well, this is not going to work. So I'm going to go to sobriety, slowness, degrowth. And of course, this sounds this can be exciting, actually. It's really for your well-being, for many other things, it can be good. But we have to be realistic. In 2023, in the current society, no one is going to choose this path. Or maybe 0.1% of the population is going to go in that path, but not more. So this is not sustainable for another reason, is that there's not going to be anyone. So if you see these two alternatives, they both have problems. I mean, they both have qualities, but they mainly have problems. So we need to find another way. So when we are there, I mean, so I'm going fast, but I think you're well aware of this. So I want to spend more time on the rest. We are a bit like in an impasse, right? So dead end. When we see this, we see that the sustainable development is not going to take us anywhere, and degrowth as well. So maybe we can get some inspiration from this old guy, Dwight Eisenhower. So if you can't solve a problem, enlarge it. And I think it's actually a deep thinking, right? Because usually when we have a problem and we tap into the problem, we actually narrow it down even further. We should do exactly the opposite. Look at the interactions, look at the larger picture. And so this is what I'm going to try to do today and to give you a sort of a view on this. So if we agree that the key word of the century is the word fluctuation, we're going to be in a fluctuating world. So now if we look at what we're doing, so we are in this fluctuating world, but we are still in our heads with the mentality of people in a stable world. So all the technology, all the social advancement, let's say, that we do is still very much into the spirit of a stable world, so with abundant resources. So what we do actually, usually, I mean, that's what I say here, is that actually we take aspirin. It's like we are in a fluctuating world. The world is going to fluctuate even more and more. And what we do, we take aspirin to, you know, to lower the fever. But we don't cure the cause. We cure the symptoms, not the cause. So here I take, for instance, in agriculture. In agriculture, what we do, we reduce the fluctuation with pesticides, fertilizer, irrigation. And with this, you have a field that has a stable local environment. But by doing this, you generate instabilities for the longer term, right? You create a desert, basically. New resources. So for instance, you've heard about deep sea mining, for instance. So we have a shortage of rare metals. So what we're going to do is to go to the deep sea to pick up all these rare metals. Very bad idea. If you follow Denis Meadows' report, this is just going to generate more pollution and it's not going to change the trajectory. So that doesn't work. Quantitative easing, right? We just produce a lot of money, a lot of debt, but in the end, we don't solve anything, right? It's just a short-term social benefit, but that's it. We don't solve anything. So this is really all the world of aspirin, right? And we are really into this aspirin. We are like completely addicted to this aspirin, right? So all these are addictions, right? So now if we are in an unstable world, so we need to land. So a little bit like what Bruno Latour was saying, like we need to land on Earth. We need to stop this fiction that we are on Earth, but in an Earth that we can control, that we can optimize. No, we can't control it. We can't optimize it. The Earth has some limits and we just need to live within its limits. And so that means that we need to agree that we've lost the control. And we need to agree that we need to live in a world where we have lost the control. And this is very different from the Renaissance. It's different from the Neolithic age. This is really a bifurcation from human history, right? So maybe I should insist on this. So if you think of the Neolithic age, right, 10,000 years ago, it's the start of agriculture, domestication, when people start building cities. This can be summarized in one sentence, the Neolithic age. It's when humans want to control nature. Today, we've lost control. The nature that we thought we had controlled, we threaten nature, and nature is threatening us. So we are really in a feedback, right? And so we have lost control. And so now instead of controlling even more, what we should do is to live in a world where we have lost control and learn how to live in a world where we've lost control. And so this is what I'm going to try to tell you today. So why do I say that as a biologist? Because living organisms, that's what they do. They don't try to control their environment. They just know how to live in an unstable world. And so there's a lot to learn from these living organisms. And this is this the third way, which is not sustainable development. This is not degrowth. It's something else. It's bio-inspired. So you look at how living organisms are living. You try to extract some principles and see if those principles can be helpful to live in an unstable world. Not to say that we should copy everything that is in biology and just get some inspiration and then adjust it to social systems. Okay, so I'm going to start with a few key principles of biology that could be useful to live in an unstable world. It's okay. I mean, maybe I go too fast. So tell me, it's okay. Yeah. All right. Okay. So I keep on going. So this is just a schematic, let's say, to show you a little bit a view. Of course, it's too simple just to get some clear ideas. So this is what I call our humans work, or I should say our modern humans work, because it's not always been like this. So when we have a problem, we humans, when we have a problem, usually we tap into some resource and we find a solution. So for instance, if I want to travel far away, I'm going to burn kerosene, take a plane, and I will arrive at destination. If I want to download a movie, I'm going to burn some metals with 5G and then have my movie, right? So this, in this world, we do a lot of extraction and we do very little interaction. This is the world of extraction. It's an extractivist model. So on the planet, there are only two types of organisms that are working like this: humans and parasites. That's it. Everyone else, they're doing this. So let me go there. So we also have problems. I mean, they also have problems, all these living organisms. But instead of going straight to the resource, they let that problem, you know, like for a long time, right? It's sort of macerate. you stay with your problem for a longer time. If you stay longer with your problem, you're going to aggregate partners. So the peas are partners. So you're going to aggregate different partners. You see there are different colors. So these are heterogeneous partners, different types of partners. And with these partners, each partner is connected to a problem, is connected to a solution, to other partners, and you're going to find a path through the partners that arrives to the solution. And you see that the word resource has disappeared. So of course, there are still resources here, but it's a flux of resources. The resources are regenerated. So there's not a stock of resources, if you want. Or to say it in a different way, you create solutions with a constant stock. And this is how all living organisms are working. If you take your body, a human body is working like this. An ecosystem is working like this. A forest is working like this. Anything living organism-wise is working like this. So that's the first thing. And so here you see the switch. It's the inverse. Here we do a lot of extraction, little interaction. There we do little extraction, a lot of interactions, but really a lot of interactions, a lot more. And so if we think that we are going, I mean, we're already in a society of scarce resources, right? There is a shortage of resources all over the place. So we will have no choice. We will have to move to this. There's no way out. We can't keep on going like this, right? It's thermodynamically, it's impossible, right? So we'll have to move to this. And the good news, I would say, for you today is that this world, the one on the right here, is much more engaging because we are entering the world of the rich interactions. We are living the world of poor interactions in addition to the world of burnout and all this, right? Okay, that's just the first point, but I want to go a little bit deeper with this, and I'm going to summarize a lot of biology into three principles, just to give you some keywords, right? Just to give you some key principles. So the first one, and I think everyone knows this, is the principle of circularity. So all living organisms are included in the cycle of the Earth, right? So if you think of the water cycle, for instance, all living organisms are part of the water cycle. So here you see like a tree in the temperate climate that evaporates 500 liters of water every day. So it's a lot of water. And so you see that the plants are completely included in the water cycle. And you know that plants, they are the organisms that are bringing water to the continent, right? So if you're in the middle of a continent and you see a cloud, that cloud is coming from a plant. Huh? If you see a river in the middle of a continent, it's coming from a plant. It's not like this, there was no water before. It's really the plants that are bringing the water. But I guess for this, you know that it's already a model for the economy, right? If you think of circular economy, it's this idea, right? But you start to include all our activities into the cycle of society and the earth, right? So there's no big surprise here, right? Circularity, key principle. Okay. Second principle is that during evolution, living systems have been selected with their ability to live as a group. It's the resilience of the group that is selected and not individual comfort. That's the target in evolution, which, I mean, depending on what you heard about Darwin, for instance, you might not have this impression, right? Because when you some misconception on Darwin's book and the Origin of Species gives a little bit the impression that it's the individual, that's the best individual that is succeeding and is going to be the next generation. This is absolutely not what Darwin said. So it's just to, but anyway, so that's the idea, right? It's the resilience of the group that is selected over time. And there is a link to the amount of resources in the environment. So here we can take this little example. So this is like an experiment, if you want. So imagine you're in a mountain and there is a forest. You're at the bottom of the forest. So the soil at this stage, at the bottom of the forest, the soil are rich. Temperature is fine. There's a lot of water. There's a lot of resources. So there's abundance of resources. And what we're going to do, we're going to unearth one tree. So you remove one tree. If you remove one tree, you probably have seen that the other trees are going to benefit from this, right? So they're going to grow more. They're going to make more branches. They're going to make more leaves. So that means that they were in competition before. So when there's abundance of resources, there is competition. Now, if you go to the top of the mountain, so the soil at the top of the mountain, where it's really cold, there's snow and everything. So the soils are poor. There's a lot of wind, it's very cold, there's a lot of UVs. So it's really a harsh environment. So rather a scarcity of resources. If you remove one tree, the tree around are going to decrease their biomass. They're going to suffer. Because in this case, you removed a partner. You know that trees are communicating with one another through their roots, right? The roots are connected to fungi. The fungi are, you know, exchanging nutrients, signals, and everything. So if you remove one tree, you remove a provider of nutrients and chemicals and all this. And you also broke a line of communication. Right? So it's not surprising that when you remove one tree and you're in harsh conditions, then the other trees are suffering. And so the rule is that when there is a shortage of resources, living systems are switching to cooperation. And this is a key factor, right? So because that means that living systems, they can do competition, but they allow competition only when resources are abundant. When it's scarcity, they switch to cooperation. And this is true for a forest. This is true for yeast in test tubes. This is true for the cell of your body. This is true for penguins, for bees, I mean, whatever, right? So any living, it's a universal rule in biology, this link with cooperation. So these are two collective ways to work. But you see, when there's a shortage of resources, they switch to cooperation. So of course, if you think of social systems today, right? So if we know where we are, right? So if you've heard about the limits, the boundary, the planetary boundaries, the Meadows report, Club of Rome, and all this, we have reached the limits of the planet. We are in a shortage, the era of shortage of resources. We're actually beyond the shortage of resources. We're generating debts for the next generations. And we are still in a world where the world competition and the competitivity is still seen as something positive. Right? So this, you will never see it in living organisms. This never happens. When there is shortage of resources, there is no competition. The only moment where you can see this is before a collapse event. Otherwise, it never exists. But it's common sense, right, in a way. If there's little resources, you don't want to compete for resources. Yep.
That forest, that trees, they're kind of a sunlight, right?
Uh-huh.
you will have scarcity of sunlight and no cooperation, but actually competition.
Yeah. So the competition for light is a bit difficult because I'm going to talk about it later, actually, because the yield of photosynthesis is super low as well. And so actually it's true that plants are competing for light, but they cooperate in the sense that they put the plants at different stages. So plants are adapted to the level of light they receive. So it looks like a competition for us, but actually they're adapted to the level of light they have. If you see what I mean, right? So if there are plants that are adapted to be under a forest where there is little light, and there are plants that are adapted to be really in the bright light, right? So it's not so much a competition than an adaptation, let's say, to different light conditions. And the light actually is never really a limit. The sun is actually, there isn't too much light. Plants are really, they are accepting less than 1% of the sunlight. So it's not a problem. The limiting factor mostly is the nutrients in the soil, or the quality of the soil. That's where or the water. But we can talk about it later. But I think for this cooperation idea, I think this is also coming, right, in the economy with the rise of cooperatives, much more like a cooperative work and interactions. So I would say we can see the light a little bit, even though there's a lot of competition, so it's a bit like a hiatus, let's say. But that's not the thing I want to talk about the most. I want to talk about the third principle, which is the principle of robustness. And I'm actually only going to talk about this principle of robustness. So robustness, I need to define what it is. So robustness, it's to maintain the stability of the system despite fluctuation. Maintaining the stability of the system despite fluctuation. That's the definition of robustness. And it turns out that living systems are selected during evolution on their ability to be robust. Robustness is the criteria for evolution. It's not performance. And actually, it's even worse than this, because when we study living systems, we realize that they build their robustness against performance. So against efficacy and against efficiency. That's how living systems are working. So here you have a number of, let's say, sub-principles. So if you dig into what is a living systems and you look at neural networks, gene networks, interactions in a forest or in the cells in your body, you will find this principle or sub-principle. So inefficiency, most processes in biology are very, very inefficient. They are very wasteful. A lot of heterogeneity, and there's the biodiversity, but there's also biodiversity at the molecular level, at all scales, at the cell level. A lot of randomness, a lot of the processes in biology are stochastic, so they are very, very random. A lot of slowness, a lot of delays, again, in gene networks and neural networks, there's a lot of delays. A lot of redundancy. But a lot, you think million, it's not like an electric generator, right? So it's a million of redundancy, right? So it's a lot more. A lot of inconsistency or incoherence. So if you look at the loops, the interactions in gene networks, there's a lot of amplifying loop, like really positive loops, but a lot more of incoherent loop. So an incoherent loop or inconsistency, it's like when you have a protein that is activating something and also inhibiting the same thing. Or it's as if you were driving a car and you had the foot on the accelerator and on the brake at the same time. This is how living systems are working. And all this is incomplete, because if it was complete, it would be finished and it would be dead, right? So all this counter performance is building the robustness of living beings. And this is where we have, I think, a lesson to take for our society, because you saw that performance that is often put forward as a solution to many of our problems is counterproductive. Turns out that living systems have questioned performance in some ways, right? Or at least have a different way to approach an unstable world, which is to build robustness against performance. So I'm going to give you examples, because this is very theoretical. So I'm going to dig deeper into this and try to demonstrate a little bit. So I'm just going to take two or three examples. So this is the example of body temperature. So we have a body temperature of 37 degrees, right? But if we extract the proteins and the enzymes of your body and we put them in a test tube and then we measure the activity of these enzymes, we are going to find usually the optimum is at 40 degrees. It's not 37 degrees, it's 40 degrees. So you could say, well, 40 degrees, 37 degrees, it's about the same. It's not the same. So at 40 degrees, there are certain enzymes that are 1 million times more active at 40 degrees than 37 degrees. So that means that when your body is at 37 degrees, your body is satisfying, let's say, but not more. It's not working super well. It's just working well, but not more. At 40 degrees, your body is at the top of its performance. That's where your performance is maximal. So it can be a bit counterintuitive, right? Because this is when you have fever, right? So you're usually pretty dead. But actually, it's also an adaptation, right? So your brain, you're a bit like, sleepy and everything. But your body, your enzymes, that's really where they're at the maximum of their performance. And in particular, your immune system. At 40 degrees, your immune system is at the top. So you see, there is a simple philosophical message here. Is that we are not at the maximum of performance to allow the management of fluctuation. So at 37 degrees, our body is not working very well. A pathogen enters, then we switch, we move to 38, 39, 40 degrees. And then now we have a good immune system that is going to take care of the pathogen. And then we come back to 37 degrees, right? We don't keep maximizing performance, right? We go back to the baseline. So see the message, right? So what has been selected is a suboptimal solution. We don't go to the optimum, we go to the suboptimum. And we allow performance. We allow performance, but it has to be transient, 2 or 3 days, not more. Yep. Yeah, I'm not sure follow. Yeah.
It would be interpreted. Like, you can have the same result and interpret it in the other way. Make an argument that your body is actually efficient.
Well, I guess it comes down to the definition of performance. For me, my definition of performance is very simple. Right? It's like the sum of efficacy and efficiency. And 37 degrees is not efficient. It's not, on a day-to-day basis, you could be much more efficient. It's just that when you have a pathogen, then indeed, that's the where you're the most efficient, and that's where you can kill the pathogen. But I would say this is really not efficient. Huh? You have enzymes that are really not doing much at 37 degrees. Huh? So I'm not sure. I guess it's efficiency. If you broaden the definition of efficiency, right? So if you say that efficiency is also managing fluctuation, then it would be efficient, right? But I prefer to have a very strict definition so that it's we know what we're talking. Question. Well, I mean, yeah. So, yeah. Yeah, the way I can. So it's a global optimum. So, for instance, temperature, you can't have a temperature for every single enzyme, right? Enzymes are in a cell. And so you can't have 38 degrees in one corner of the cell and then next to it 35 degrees. And then, so you need to have a compromise. So in that sense, it's an optimum or a Pareto optimum. But what I'm interested here is that when you select the different enzymes, actually globally, it's better at 40 degrees than at 37 degrees. So even globally, it's still true. It comes down to the definition of optimum. But I think it's normal. We have a resistance to this, right? Optimum. Actually, even optimum, it sounds like optimism, right? So it sounds very positive. And so we think that we need to be at the optimum. And when we look at the living systems, they're far away from the optimum, very far. This is for mammalians or birds. They're the one at 37 degrees. If you think of a fish is also, it has pretty much the same enzyme. The optimum is also at 40 degrees. So I can tell you that the fish is very rarely at the optimum. So it's yeah, again, you or we keep the question for later or. Yeah, exactly. So when you do sport, you don't go to 40 degrees, yeah? But you can go to 38 degrees, so you can warm up a little bit, and you're going to be more efficient. So actually, it also makes sense, right? I mean, if you're doing sport, I mean, not in biology, of course, it was not selected for sport. Huh? It was like there's a tiger in your back, and you want to run, right? So it makes sense that you're a bit more efficient. But it's a bit like a pathogen, if you want, but an external one. Okay, so that's for body temperature. Just to give you the idea, I mean, the main take-home message is that the living organisms are not at their optimum. And they are far from their optimum. They are not performant, they are robust. Robustness is built against performance. I have another example that maybe is more convincing, and that's actually the case of photosynthesis. So if you think of photosynthesis, we could say it's the most important metabolic process on Earth. That's what transforms a gas, CO2, into carbon fibers. So if you look at a plant, it's only carbon fibers, pretty much. And all this carbon is polymerized CO2, if you want. That's photosynthesis, right? And you do all this with light. So it's really amazing. Huh? So photosynthesis exists, it has been existing for 3.8 billion years. 3.8 billion years. So it's a very, very old process. 3.8 billion years, so we could think that there's been time to optimize photosynthesis, right? Even a lot of time to optimize the photosynthesis, and the yield of photosynthesis is less than 1%. When we measure it in the fields, it's 0.3 to 0.8%. So when I say yield, it's the difference between the energy that arrives on the leaf and the metabolic energy that is coming out of the plant or of the leaf, right? So that means that plants, in other words, it means that plants are wasting 99% of the solar energy. So that is definitely not performant. I mean, you would agree, but it's not zero. It's not zero. It's 0.3 to 0.8. So it's not zero, but it's close to zero. And here I put solar panels here because you see we build solar panels for, I mean, we've been building solar panels for 50 years, and we're already at around 15% of fields. So of course, it's not the same. It's another light capture system. But still, in 50 years, we've already beaten photosynthesis, right? 3.8 billion years, 50 years. So why are plants so stupid, right? That's the other question, right? So why can't plants capture all the light, or at least 15%? I would be 10 times better, right? And so the first thing you should see on this image is that solar panels, they are black, and plants are green. So that means that plants, they are really stupid, right? Because if you want to capture all the light, you want to be black, right? So it's the black color that absorbs all the rainbow wavelengths, right? So if you're black, you're going to absorb all the light. If you're white, you're not going to absorb anything. And if you're green, you're going to absorb the red and the blue. So the two extremes of the rainbow, and whatever is in the middle, you reflect like a mirror. And that's why plants appear green to us, because they reflect the green light. And it goes in our eyes, and we see plants are green. So plants should be black if they wanted to be. I mean, they don't want anything, but if they were to be more performant, right? So the question is, why are plants green? And we have, so it's been a process, but we have a formal answer only since 2020. So it's quite a recent finding. And it's quantum physics. So I won't be able to go into the full details of the explanation, but I can give you like the sort of the average take-home message. From that study, so what they showed is that if you want to have the maximum performance for photosynthesis, you want the photon, so the light particle, to come regularly, right? So they need to come at a very regular level, right? But actually, of course, in real life, that's not what's happening, right? There is fluctuation in light, between the morning, the afternoon, the clouds, temperature, I mean, the quality, the quantity of light is changing all the time. And actually, it's more important in the plant, it's also fluctuating. The cells are dividing, they are dying, they are regenerating, the proteins, the same, all the molecules are moving all over the place. So you have fluctuation outside, and you have fluctuation inside. what is the solution in a, such a fluctuating environment? This study shows that there's only one solution. It's to absorb in the blue, and it's to absorb in the red. And you need to have two peaks of absorption that are away from one another to allow fluctuation in light and in biology. So I think there's a strong philosophical message here, is that the question is, why are plants green? The answer is that plants are managing fluctuation, fluctuation, fluctuation. It's never a question of performance. Never, actually, and you see, less than 1%. That's the example for plants. And I have maybe one last example. It's also a recent study that is building on, again, decades of analysis on bacteria. So if you look at bacteria, I mean, they look like these little rods, right? So when you look at bacteria in a petri dish, they all look the same, right? They are all little rods. But actually, when you start looking at their gene expression, you see that it's much more variable, it's much more stochastic, random. I mean, they're all different. There's also a large biodiversity, a molecular biodiversity in those bacteria. And so one of the questions was, how come the bacteria can resist to antibiotics? You know, antibiotics, they are super harsh, right? And it's always bacteria that are resisting to antibiotics. And so this study, but many other studies have shown that, I could say that if we are humans, we would be a little bit like Russia and Ukraine. You would build even more weapons, and then you want to fight even more, you want to fight even more. And in the end, you kill each other, right? What bacteria are doing, they are sleeping. That's their line of defense. They sleep, they hibernate. And when you increase the level of stress, they hibernate even more. So there's really a correlation, right? So if you really if you put bacteria in a very, very harsh environment, they're going to really sleep for a long time, and a larger population of bacteria is going to sleep. So this is, again, a solution that is going against performance to manage fluctuations. I'm not going to go, there are hundreds of examples like this. Huh? And now, I mean, the news, I guess, is, so we used to know this in ecosystems, like maybe 20 years ago, 40 years ago. The news from the past 20 years is that we've shown this rule, this fact that robustness is built against performance, this rule has been demonstrated at the molecular level as well. So now it's a principle that goes from the molecule to the ecosystem. So we are pretty sure it's true. And so these are like some examples, but there are many others. I just showed you two or three. You can, there are really, as I said, hundreds more, where you see all these counter performances, right? Heterogeneity, randomness, redundancy, etc. It's all fueling the adaptability of the plant or the living systems, actually. I shouldn't say only the plant, all living systems. And adaptability is one ingredient of robustness, if you want, or it's the main ingredient of robustness. Okay, that's clear enough, yeah? Robustness against performance. Yeah. It's a very simple message, but it's a strong one, I think. So I'm going to summarize everything I've been telling you today in one curve. So this is, I'm showing you human progress. So it's a very simplistic way to look at it, but just to have some clear ideas. So if you think of human progress, an important part of human progress is an increase in performance. Over the years, over the decades, over the centuries, we've increased performance, right? So if you come from the Neolithic age, Middle Age, Renaissance, I mean, Industrial Revolution, the explosion of the 20th century with all the innovation, it's always an increase in performance. The problem now is that in the 21st century, we realize that the more we increase performance and the more the viability of humanity on Earth is threatened. So the more we increase performance, the more we are in a dead end. So you could think, okay, sustainable development, what it's doing to this. So sustainable development, it's often based on efficacy and efficiency. So it's also based on performance. So we are not changing the trajectory. It's always the same thing. And you saw with the rebound effect, good ortho and all this, performance is also self-justifying. So we are not going to change trajectory with sustainable development. If you think of degrowth, so we would go in the other direction, right? We go in this direction. So you would think, okay, well, we're going to be a bit more viable. But as we discussed, very few people are going to go voluntarily in degrowth. Degrowth is something that is imposed to you, but usually you don't voluntarily want to degrow, right? If you want to be clear. So what is the future, right? What is the future? What is how can we define progress in the 21st century? I would like to suggest that progress in the 21st century is going to be this. You need to change axis. if you think that the world is going, it has always been fluctuating, but the world is going to fluctuate even more, then you do not want to increase performance. You want to increase robustness. And to increase robustness, you need to decrease performance. And for me, that's the main take-home message. If the main take-home message from the scientific report is that the world is going to be more fluctuating, the operational answer to a world that is fluctuating is robustness, maintaining the stability of the system despite the fluctuation. And we saw from the living systems that this robustness, you can build it if you go against performance. So now you don't do degrowth just to degrow. You go against performance to build something else, to build robust systems. So this is probably a bit theoretical. So I want to give you some concrete example of this switch, because the good news is that we've already switched. It's just we need to open our eyes to see that this new world is actually already there. We just have to push on the accelerator to go in that direction. So I'm going to give you some examples to also fuel the discussion. So I'm going to start with a very simple one, is agriculture. So agriculture, so this is an image of a maize field. So this is, let's say, a classic image of intensive agriculture, green revolution, right? So this is where you use a lot of pesticides, a lot of fertilizer, a lot of irrigation. You use the best genetic crop, and then you have the maximal yield. So this is the era of performance. And as you all know, this has many, many negative externalities. Two of them, among many others, but two of them is generating a desert. So you're killing the soil. So you're like really killing the ability for the future agriculture. And you're also killing farmers, right? I mean, this system is slavery for farmers in some ways, right? You are really putting a distance between the farmers and their work. So what would be the robust switch to this? Of course, it goes around agroecology. So I know that there are many people from Latin America here. So this is really where it started, agroecology. South America, Latin America, this is where it's actually it has happened in the 80s, much before Europe. But agroecology, and before going into permaculture, agroforestry, like things that are a bit evolved, if you have the same farmer, same field, what can you do to make that field more robust? You can do one simple thing, is to switch to varietal mixtures. So what is varietal mixture? So instead, in this case, it's wheat. So instead of growing the best wheat, the best species of wheat, the best variety of wheat, you grow three different varieties of wheat together as a mix, right? So you have three genetic difference, right? Three, it's heterogeneous in the field, let's say. There's a genetic diversity in the field, three different varieties of wheat. So of course, your yield is going to be lower because you haven't put the best variety, right? So you're going to have a decrease in performance. But what do you gain? And this has been demonstrated for decades now. This field that is with a varietal mixture, it's more resistant to drought, and it's more resistant to pathogens, only because you've increased the genetic diversity. So what happens here is that when you have genetic diversity in the field, the different wheat plants here, they are in a way talking to each other, right? They are exchanging nutrients, a little bit like the forest, like the trees in the forest, right? They are going to exchange nutrients, they're going to exchange signals, and that field as a collective, the field is more resistant to drought and is more resistant to pathogens. And this is a scientific fact. You see, there's no question about this. We know it works. But what's not what interests me the most is that actually we've already switched to this system. And so here I take the example of France, but it's true in other places in Europe. So this is in 2010. 2010, that's the surface that was grown in wheat as varietal mixture. And you saw that it was the minority, right? In 2010, only 5%, around 5%, was cultivated as varietal mixture. You see 2020, so actually Hérault, like, so that's around Montpellier, so in the south of France, it's close, it's 44%. So that means that in 10 years, it's already shifted, right? And this is not going to stop. Actually, it's the farmers that they see that it works. They see that actually it's also they also save money, right? Because they have to use less fertilizer, less pesticides, I mean, for many reasons, it's positive, right? And so here, we don't need to have a researcher explain to the farmers that it's the best way to go. We just see it because it is working. And so you see, this is, again, robustness built against performance, right? And this is the simplest case, only varietal mixture. So you can imagine that it can be much more evolved if you're doing permaculture and all this. So this is my first tipping point in this new world where we progress is switching from performance to robustness. And it's an inversion. You know, in the ecology, we say the word transition, bifurcation, sustainable development, I mean, all these words. No, the world is an inversion. We are living in a world that is completely inversing all everything, basically. So here, that's the example in agriculture. So before, in the world of performance, the world of stability, if you want, we were using ecosystem to increase production. That was the world of performance. Today, the question we ask is how production can feed ecosystems. So it's really the inverse. And so that means that if you're a farmer and you have a parcel, a plot, you will want not only to have the highest yield in grains, you will want to have auxiliary insects, you want to have a living soil, you want to cooperate with your neighbor farmers, for instance, to do your varietal mixture, right? Because you need to mix the mix, et cetera, right? So it's all this way. And it's really an inversion. So I'm going to give you a second example, and it's more like related to engineering. So in, for instance, in construction, you know, we have access now to very performing, super efficient, super efficacious materials to build houses that are not emitting any, I mean, that are like, you don't have to put a heater, right? So it's so well insulated that it's, you don't have even to put a heater in your house. The only problem with those materials is that they cost a lot of energy to build. Sometimes they pollute the interiors, and then you still need energy to dismantle them at the end. So the ecological balance of those new materials is a bit questionable. So now there's much more interest in other materials that are less performant, less efficacious, less efficient, but more robust. And so this is the example of mud bricks. So you know, like mud bricks, like muds, that's something you can find. So if you see the soil, right below the soil, you have this sort of clay. You can make these bricks. You put these bricks in the sun. The sun, it's about 340 watts per square meter. So that's enough energy to cook your bricks. And then you can build a house with this. So it's one fourth of housing in the world is made of mud bricks. Huh? So it's not anecdotal. Huh? This is actually a main construction material. So this is definitely not as performant as other materials. So for instance, this, if you have water coming into the wall is going to fall. So this is not super performing. So you need to have a very waterproof ceiling, right? So a roof. Huh? But if you have this, and if you know how to build it, then it's something that is, it has many qualities, acoustic, thermic qualities, but it's also easy to build. Easy to build, that means that anyone can build their house, or any group can build their house. You can repair your own house, you can adapt your own house. So it's robust in the sense that it's adaptable. You can adapt it constantly. And so this, again, the good news is that maybe in 20 years ago, it was like a few people who were like still exploring this. Now, in like, for instance, in this French school for public work, for construction, now there is a field. I mean, there is a subgroup of the engineers that are studying this only, but bricks, wood, straw, like this kind of materials, less performing, but more robust. And it's developing everywhere. Huh? There's OICOS, that's also an association that is promoting this. So I mean, it's really on the rise, right? So again, less performance, more robust. Another example, just to give you the idea that it's this idea of robustness, it's not a question of going backwards, right? Because you could think that with varietal mixtures, with mud bricks, it's like the good old traditional way to build houses or to grow the fields. No, no, the question of switching from performance to robustness is only a question of choice. And I'm going to illustrate this with new technologies. So you won't tell me that it's only in the back, backwards or in the past. So for instance, if we wanted for email, when you send email, if we wanted to have the most efficient way to send email. So we would write an email. The email would go through the shortest cable, and then it would arrive at the destination, right? So that would be the most efficient way to send an email. But that's not what has been decided, right? That's not the way the emails are sent. So the protocol we use for sending email is the TCP/IP protocol. And this protocol is the following. So you write your email. The email is broken into pieces, the packets. Those packets are replicated. So there's a lot of redundancy. They go through different cables, heterogeneous cables. Cables are more or less long, so there are delays. Some packets are lost, there are errors, but at the end, the packets are reassembled and your message arrives. So this is not an efficient way to send an email. It's definitely not efficient, right? You see all the, well, I mean, all this thing, right? There's lots of cables, I don't know, but it's robust. It's robust because if that cable was going through a war zone, you would not be able to send email anymore, right? So this has been designed to be robust. So it's just a question. Robustness is not going backwards. It's just it's acknowledging that the world is unstable. If the world is unstable, you want to fuel robustness. You don't want to fuel performance. And so that means that's the second tipping point. That means that we're going to reinvent what is an engineer. So in the 21st century, or at least in the 20th century, so in the era of performance, the engineer was someone who would increment performance, who would make performance even higher. And through technical distant delegation. Think of the smartphone, right? I'm sure many of you have a smartphone, if not all of you have a smartphone. How many of you can repair your smartphone? I guess nobody, right? So that means that we have lost control of a tool that is more and more necessary for everyday life, right? So this is the world of performance, right? So the engineer, it's like it's so much more complex, but now it's completely distant from us. By the way, engineer, it's a word, the etymology of engineer, it's a word from the 16th century, and it means someone who builds the war machines, catapults and forts. That's an engineer. So it's really, an engineer is the agent of war and performance, right? So we are going to switch to something much more engaging. So this is this. So the new engineer, so the engineer in the world of robustness, what they are doing, they are promoting techno-diverse solutions. So my discourse is not technophobic. I hope I'm not giving this impression. On the contrary, it's technophilic because in this case, if you want to be robust, you want to preserve all the technologies, absolutely all the technologies. A lot of heterogeneity, a lot of redundancy, right? When you develop the best technology, usually what happens is that that technology is so efficient that it kills all the other ones. And then you're very vulnerable because you only depend on one technology, right? So this is much more robust. And of course, the goal of an engineer in the 21st century is to have technical autonomy of citizens. So that means that the mission of an engineer in the 21st century is that in a village, in a region, everything is on site, everything is repairable locally, adaptable locally. You don't need to go to Taiwan to get your microprocessors. I mean, you should have everything on site. That's a challenge, huh? Of course. But that's engaging, right? There's definitely something to do here. Okay, another series of examples. I've already talked about it. But this is something you can see. I'm taking examples that you can see really in your daily life. Huh? The all repairable, right? So, I mean, if you 20 years ago, even 20 years ago, to repair something was a bit weird, right? Today, everything must be repaired. I mean, it starts to be that everything must be repaired, right? And so, yeah, I'm taking examples of French companies. So Darty, for instance, so that's a company that is selling dishwashers, coffee machine, or whatever. Now they have developed this thing called the Darty Max. So you pay $10 per month, and the contract is that they're going to repair everything in your house. So it's not anymore that you buy an equipment and then you get rid of it, you keep it, and some people are coming to repair it for life. Modification is doing the same. There are some machines that are designed like this. There's also bike workshops. You can see them in Paris everywhere, but everywhere in France and elsewhere. And I'm taking the example of Brazilec. That's a company in Brittany. So they've been working on, actually it's an interesting company because they are repairing, I see there's some people from Britain here. I see the t-shirt as well. Yeah, exactly. but it's an interesting company because I mean, they are repairing electronics. And so and for a long time, and since the 70s, the only thing is that when, let's say in the 90s, repairing electronics was a suicide, right? It was very expensive, and you could find new electronics for like a much cheaper price elsewhere, right? In Asia or elsewhere. But now with the shortage of microprocessor, the shortage of metals, now they are really, you know, they are actually opening an antenna in Australia, in the US. Now they are really like they master so much electronic repair that they are actually on top of the game, right? And so this is really a sign of a world that is changing, right? It's not the, you know, a quick and easy fix. It's the repairable. Takes more time, again, takes more time. So it's not performant, but it's more robust. And yeah, I take another, maybe a more controversial example. You know, we hear about that we need to decarbonize the economy, right? We don't want to emit CO2 anymore, so we don't want to use oil. And what do we do instead? Instead of using oil, we use metals. And so we haven't changed anything, right? So we just switch pollution, right? Instead of polluting with CO2 and oil, we pollute with rare metals, with lithium, with a lot of other things. So what we should do is not to decarbonize the economy. We need to recarbonize the economy. Recarbonizing the economy, it means that you change everything that we have with green carbon. So the only renewable resources we have on Earth, I mean, the main one, is plants. 82% of the biomass on Earth is plant-based. So if we want to be serious about you know, the new world, the new digital world, and I think we need to replace everything that is metallic into carbon, right? And so there are examples. So here I'm taking this example because I think it's symbolic of the switch. So these are the good old lithium battery, right? So we know that lithium, actually in Brittany as well, there are some issues. So lithium, yeah, problem. So you want, and there is a company in Sweden, but there are others, that found that one molecule of the wood, which is called lignin. So it's the second most abundant molecule on Earth. So we really have a ton of lignin, and usually we don't know what to do with it. It's more like waste. And they found that if you make a film of lignin, that film of lignin can store electricity. And so what they do, they make batteries made of lignin, and those batteries are biodegradable, and they can store electricity. But again, there is a price to pay. So those batteries are much bigger than the lithium batteries. So you can't put them on a car, for instance. It's only for a house, right? Or an industry, right? But again, it's interesting, right? This is switch where we realize that now this battery, when it's not functioning anymore, you put it in your garden and you know, the fungi, the mushrooms are going to eat them, right? So it's really completely biodegradable. So of course, this raises a number of other issues, right? It's the ratio between biomaterials and carbon for food, right? So, but that's a different question, but just to say that it's happening now. So that's my third tipping point. I told you, it's really an inversion. When you switch from performance to robustness, you really do the opposite of what we've been doing. So we use matter to save time, right? It's like burning kerosene to take a plane. And now in the robust world, we use time to save matter. And that's, for instance, the circular bioeconomy, right? So we need to grow the plants to get the carbon, to get the material. It's going to be slower. It's going to be less performant. It's going to be less efficient. But it's more robust because there's no pollution, it's adaptable. You can grow your material everywhere, not only in where you have the mines. So you see, it's really a different world. I'm going to finish with this one, which is probably the most important one. It's the switch from competition to cooperation. And again, it's a question of switch from performance to robustness. So if you think of a school, in the French system, I should say, because I don't know so much the other systems. In the French system, as it used to be and still very much the case, there's a lot of competition. If you think of to reach the best schools or to reach the grandes écoles and all this, there's a lot of competition, and the students are rated on their performance. And so this is generating, as expected, burnout of the professors, burnout of the students, and a lot of distance between the schooling system and the citizens. So you can think of a different way to do this. And this picture is an image of a school that was invented in Italy, actually, and then has been exported to France. That was in 1747, so a long time ago. It was called the Mutual School. And in those schools, there was no teacher. And what the students were doing, or the pupils were doing, they were exchanging ideas. So they trained themselves with one another, right? Maybe they had a priest or two that were like giving some advice, but that's it, right? And so what happened with those schools is that there was a lot of interactions. And in 1747, those schools, actually the kids in those schools were going twice faster than the school with professors. And so, of course, in 1747, they stopped it, right? Completely, right? Because of course there was a problem with the posture of the professor and etc. Right? I mean, in those days. Now, of course, there's a lot of revival for this. Hein? Maybe you've heard so pédagogie freinée in France, but there are many Montessori. I mean, there's a lot of alternatives to the schooling system. And always in this alternative system, in Finland, for instance, and Finland is a classic example for this type of schooling. So what you have is that if the students are working themselves to get the knowledge, this is active pedagogy, so they're going to really find the information themselves, so it's going to be robust, but robust in terms of robust learning. It's working only if the students are cooperating with each other. So this is a school of cooperation. You learn the soft skills, let's say, of cooperating, of exchanging ideas, teamwork. And also every day the kids have a moment of recognition, because every day there's one time where they have the position, the posture of the professor, right? So they're going to teach something to someone else. And so you see the relationship with school is very, very different, right? And so this is, performance to robustness, right? Of course, this is more complex. Huh? That's why it's less, in terms of performance, it can be less, right? It can take more time, there's more conflicts, because you also can have some gaps in the teaching, right? Because there's not like, a framework and everything. So it's less performing, but more robust. And this is the equivalent if you go after school. So this is organizations, companies that have decided to put cooperation before competition. So like this is a nurse cooperative, this is a cooperative housing. So I'm not going to go into the details, but there's a lot more of this where it's much more horizontal. It's much more based on the interactions, much less on extraction. And in the end, you have a collective that is more robust. Also because it knows how to manage conflicts. Right, so it adds this extra component, right? So it's fluctuating outside and inside, but manages through this period. Okay, so tipping point four, that's my last one. But again, it's an inversion. So before, economic growth was built on performance, on competition, centralization, poor interaction, right? It's the world of extraction. So that's a dead end. And so if we switch to robustness, that's a society that is built on the abundance of interaction. And this is where there is the true abundance, right? It's the interactions. And of course, decentralization. Okay, so I think I don't need to say more on this. This is the balance. So this balance, what it means, right? So that if you're in an unstable environment, you want to increase robustness, but you can't have a very robust system that is also very performant. It's always a trade-off. So if you increase robustness, you will have to decrease performance. Or if you increase performance, you're going to decrease robustness somewhere, right? It's always a trade-off. Okay, sorry, maybe one last, I still have time. Yeah, just okay, 30 seconds. I just want to say this idea of robustness goes beyond the socio-ecological question. Think of you yourself as a human body, as a human, as a person communicating with other person. The way you communicate with others is a robust way. The way we communicate with each other is a robust way. It's not a performant way. So here, I'll take the example of calligraphy, because when you write something, we all have different types of writing, right? And we all write more or less well, right? But we can more or less all read each other. So that means that we are not performant. We are not very efficient in terms of writing, right? We don't write like a Word software, right? So there's some room in the way we write. But this room allows everyone else to understand each other. So that means that what makes communication effective, it's not its precision. It's its imprecision that makes it universal, right? Because it's imprecise, it is universal, right? Because there's some room around the writing. And so maybe I can just give that one example. So this is a robust text, right? You can read it, right? More or less. Yes, right? more or less. So yeah, it's we don't have to read the text, but just so there's almost no words in this text that are in the dictionary, right? But our brain can, you know, recapitulate the words and everything, right? So that means that we've invented the syntax, a grammar, a vocabulary that is our way to write a text that is robust, but is not performant. Here you allow a lot of typos, a lot of errors. Okay, so I'm going maybe to switch this one. So if you want to dig deeper into this, I've written a book. It's in French though, but it's going to be an English translation at some point. My editor is quite suboptimal. So, and there's more resources on YouTube as well. But sadly, it's mostly in French. And you can go in the Institut Michel Serres. There's also some resources. And I can take one.
Thank you.
Yes. I'll go around. And I'm going to take some water actually. J'ai tout laissé comme ça. Ça va, j'ai pas été... En fait, j'étais trop lent ou trop rapide?
Non, j'étais un peu plus long que vous. Mais
d'accord, ça va?
Ouais.
J'ai mis un chou. Bien, ok, j'étais un peu long alors.
Recording in progress.
So optimal systems. Yes.
Maybe, yeah. Okay.
Good. Well, first, thank you very much for your presentation. Just to stop the sound getting out from this computer.
Say something.
Hello.
No.
Sinon, tu peux faire quitter le Zoom.
Non, si, si, sinon.
Hello. Okay. Good. So, we will present a bit a little discussion of your presentation, and more especially, maybe we can specify that we have worked also on this article that you have written. So maybe a few of the discussions that we'll bring, or some things, have not all been brought up during your presentation. So how we will function. Yes. Where's Samash? Oh wait, okay. Good. Refresh Samash. Good. We'll have three parts. One in which we will discuss suboptimality, the second one talking more about biological and technological systems, and third about the operationalization and the relation to social sciences. But first, maybe to have a very, very quick summary, we can see that the presentation has taught us that first a constatation, the fact that the obsession of optimization has prioritized individual performance and hindered collective resilience. And then in front of this, there is a normative statement, the one that suboptimality is needed to reach sustainability since it is necessary to foster adaptability and resilience. So then, discussing a bit the concept of suboptimality, which was not directly talked about so much in the presentation, but in the end we can understand it as a bit the concept that underlies a bit all what has been discussed. So first, we can see that rational thinking coming from the Enlightenment has led to this logic of optimization. And optimization is defined in regard to its outcome in the end. So in face of this, we could think maybe suboptimality is breaking with this logic by kind of being a general principle, an approach that removes the focus from optimization and performance. But in the end, we can see that it is not only a process because it is also defined according to its outcome. So the definition is a state in which randomness, heterogeneity, slowness, redundancy, and other forms of inefficiencies at individual levels leads to robust outcomes. So we see that in the end, it's not all inefficiencies that can enter the definition of suboptimality, because suboptimality is the inefficiencies that lead to robustness. So in linked with this, we wonder which inefficiencies lead to resilience. And in other words, how suboptimal one must be to become resilient. This is something directly in the text. So this is an open question for you that we will also collect all the questions that we raised in the presentation in the last slide, so you can have them in mind when answering. You mentioned that maybe it comes back to quantifying the trade-offs between the short-term performance and the long-term resilience. So we wonder then, in this context, would the concept of suboptimality become in the end a new form of optimization, but only taking into account complexity and the long run? And if not, then how does it differ from just a general principle to be applied in all situations? And how to account for its differentiated effects. So how do you assess the level of resilience of systems? Then we wonder, you discuss a bit this idea of resilience as being the main goal. And like you said, the criteria, the target in evolution is group resilience and robustness. And this is kind of treated then as a technical discussion. But in reality, it is also a normative standpoint. And so we wonder, how does it conflict with other normative ideas, such as equality, for example, in the context where you say that fostering diversity really is important for robustness? Then we wonder, what does that mean for equality and such ideals or principles? We can say also for democracy, sufficiency, or ideas such as fundamental rights, if we say that it is fine if some individuals die for the greater good and for the population to be more resilient, then what does that mean in terms of fundamental rights, and what are the implications at that level? And then, yes, what justifies your prioritization of resilience over these other goals and values? Then I will pass to my colleague. So in the second part, I will talk about biological systems and technological systems. I will reflect on ideas that Sophie has presented and in your presentation too. When we speak about biological systems, we also need to take into account technological developments too, because if they are taking a step forward, so especially with development of smart systems, smart energy grid, smart house, smart products, smart school, it makes us think, to what extent are humans a smart system themselves? Optimization is widely praised among humans, but it cannot be said that it's a new trend, because it started a long time ago with the development of the first farming tool, such as a simple knife, to industrialization, where there was an increase in the tasks and processes that have been optimized to give us a finished product of bigger quality. We can even say that there is an optimization of an optimization. And also, even though we're living in the age of Anthropocene, that puts humans in the center of event, it's also important to say that the biosphere offers many examples that you have mentioned in your presentation, that how to optimize yourself over time. For example, the theory of evolution that has been presented by Charles Darwin is based on heterogeneity, or differences between species and individuals in the species. So in the theory, the source of suboptimality is partially in the presence of random mutations in the populations that that prevent homogeneity and provide a medium for natural selection. Darwin discovered a paradox himself, that information about past adaptive evolution is provided not by perfect adaptation of modern species, but by suboptimality. So natural selection performs local optimization at any moment as the population will slowly move to its scope and space in a direction to increase fitness, meaning how well it is adapted to its environment as an organism. Thus, modern species are can be said to be suboptimal if there was a time in their evolution when they did not reach their evolutionary peak, or initial conditions for their evolution were wrong, so that they never managed to get to the maximum degree of optimality. Darwin realized that hierarchical distributions are important, as among modern species, they carry information about their past, and that all stem from the common ancestor. Also, divergent evolution always produces hierarchies, and such evolution is expected because there is a huge phenotype that they entail. Hierarchies are informative only if they're not forced by adaptation. And even genetically identical organism in stable environments vary, because in some, a genetical mutation will show, and in others, it will not. So this might be like an incomplete mutation, because individuals may have different appearance or behavior simply because of natural fluctuation in biological processes. Any optimality analysis will be relative to certain genetic, functional, and environmental parameters, but to say that the trait is optimal means that there will be no more incremental changes in itself, and or that the genotype could be further improved, because it cannot. And this also gives it only a local context, and also it is context dependent, depending on how we perceive optimization, and it does not correlate with long-term species survival. Some evolutionary biologists, such as Van Valen, observed that the probability of extinction of a species does not vary as a function of a taxonomic age. Instead, lineage probability of going extinct is independent of its previous evolutionary success. So it doesn't mean that we as species can survive in all environments, because sometimes tragic events happen which might put an end to our lineage, not taking into account how successful we used to be. So the next part will be about technological systems. Technology has, of course, helped humans optimize the production process, work-related duties, how to organize information, maximize profit, and increase productivity. Technology can range from simple systems to complex interrelated systems, such as IT systems, telecommunications, or energy grids. The ever presence of technology in our life has also enabled the rise of a technosphere and increased our dependence on technology. This also might mean that nowadays we as humans, we do not only live in Anthropocene, but that we also live in a technocene, since technology is such a viable part of our lives. The race towards optimization also gave technology a bigger role than we might have thought before, because technology is created by humans in order to improve their lives. But also, the suboptimal mechanisms that we observe in living organisms are also seen in technologies we use because they were created by humans. Digitalization and smart systems have had a great role in decision-making in recent years because of their large capacity and the ability to share data. But even the internet can fail, because sometimes we want to send data, our connection is bad, it will fail, and we will not get the end result that we wanted. So such a system has robustness because it's a communication system. But in this case, what's different from a biological system is that this system is not evolving, since protocols that we use on the internet were created on the same way from the start and are still used nowadays. So data systems are available anywhere to a large amount of users, but they rely on duplicated data in different sites. So now what has become most popular is algorithms, because they allow process and resource optimization, and they increase reliability. However, they can only be used in short-term decision-making, because they decrease the possibility of trial and error that is present in human decision-making, and they attempt to find solutions that can satisfy the user in the shortest amount of time. So now we'll give the floor to Mathieu.
Yeah, thank you. So this last part will be about, well, you can't see it here, but operationalization of this suboptimality framework and its relations to social sciences. First, I want to go back on the scientific contribution. If we see science as the search for regularities in the universe, including humanity, here we have an important contribution showing that there is indeed regularities between biological, technological, and social systems. But the question remains of its operationalization. How can this framework bring in terms of analyzing the actions to take in front of the ecological crisis? In this paper, we have some examples of suboptimal answers to different issues, but only existing ones for now. How can it lead then to imagining new relevant answers to the ecological crisis in practice? There's already some leads in the article, though. For instance, using complex systems and evolutionary approaches in social sciences, and think about the interrelations between scale. Overall, it's taking a holistic approach. Also, that's basically the main idea of suboptimality. It's to look for elements that promote resilience and adaptability in the long run. Another question that appears here is how to find the balance in these trade-offs between individual interest and collective resilience. As Sophie pointed out, promoting blindly collective outcomes could lead to conflicts with several normative ideas or moral values. The second thing I will talk about now is the relation of this suboptimality framework to social sciences. Since it is applied to social systems, maybe social sciences could provide some useful insights too. We can start by pointing out some commonalities between the existing social sciences literature and this framework. In fact, applying this suboptimality framework to human societies corresponds to discussing the trade-offs between the interests of individuals and at the micro level and the common good at the macro level. The main idea from this framework is then that the common good should be promoted, even if it is against the interests of individuals to some extent. This echoes, of course, a very long tradition from Rousseau's social contract and probably some earlier works too, to modern political economy. this approach could be linked to all the criticisms of individualism, including the criticism of reductionism, as you said, and methodological individualism in social sciences, for instance, that we could find in neoclassical economics. As pointed out in the paper already, the suboptimality framework can be closely related to Elinor Ostrom's response to this idea of the tragedy of the commons. That is, if individuals do not seek to maximize their own short-term interests, the common resources can be managed sustainably. But the suboptimality framework also ignores some important insights, I think, provided by this literature that it could probably benefit from. If we take again Ostrom's framework, governance and the self-organization of a community benefiting from the common pool resources are key. And the agency of free will of humans will allow them, in that case, to change their collective organization with the intermediation of political mechanisms, political in a general sense here. In general, in my opinion, the paper tends to ignore political and power relations and the key role they play in making solutions to specific problems, realistic or not, in a specific context. Then suboptimal answers proposed to an issue may be relevant and applicable or not in a given social group or context, depending on the political situation in this group. This raises the question of how to reintegrate politics in this suboptimality framework. And I think here institutional economics might provide valuable insights into these questions. So to conclude, we have put a summary of the main questions we raised during this discussion. We'll let you start by.
Yeah, we'll just summarize briefly, but first, yeah, how to determine which inefficiencies lead to resilience, and in the end, is the concept of suboptimality just a new form of optimality in the long run, or otherwise, how does it differ from a general principle, and how to define in the end resilience and see where it is created. And then how does it conflict with other normative ideas and how to justify the prioritization of resilience in comparison?
So for the second part, the questions that I have is, does optimality lead to path dependence and lock-in effect over time? And to what extent do man-made genetic modifications influence the interaction between humans and the environment? And how to conserve biodiversity in a world that is so centered around humans?
And for the last part, the main question were, how can this suboptimality framework provide concrete, new and relevant answers to the current ecological crisis? And in practice, how to find this balance between the trade-offs between the individual and collective interests and collective resilience? And finally, how to reintegrate this politics and power relations into this framework? Thank you.
Lots of questions, so I will try to address. I don't know if I'll be able to address all of them, maybe and not in order, but I'll start with that one. It's probably the more general one. How can the suboptimality framework provide concrete, new, and relevant answers to the ecological crisis? So for me, I mean, this so. I don't know, of course. I mean, it's just like a sort of a theory, like a meta theory. And then, of course, concretely, it can develop into different aspects. But if I stay at that meta level, I would say it's an answer to the limits to the degrowth. If you say degrowth, it's the way to go because we are going to degrow anyway, but it's not engaging as a future. If you say that you go against performance to reach robustness, then it's more engaging. You don't degrow to degrow. You build something else. And it's an engaging, I mean, to me, at least it looks like an engaging future. You replace and you realize that there is nothing, there's not much to regret from the past era of performance. We are living the era of burnout. And so instead of fearing the future because it's going to be turbulent, fluctuating and everything, no, actually it's a chance. Because this is going to be a much more interesting future. with turbulence. But so that would be one, maybe one argument, I would say, that at least gives some positive idea. So maybe I should go back to the beginning. I was just thinking of the answer for this one. Or to determine which inefficiency leads to resilience. So I think for this, to be honest, I would say that all inefficiency may be able to provide resilience. Some of them, we haven't realized them already. Just think of just slowing down the way you can think better of your problem, spend more time on the question. If you spend more time on the question, then you're more likely to identify the right question and then provide the right answer. If I say it in a different way, if you go too fast on your question, if you don't spend enough time on your question, it's more likely that you're going to have the right answer to the wrong question. And when you look around you, we see this a lot. Huh? Think of the electric car, the gigantic windmill, all this. These are the best answers to the wrong questions. So we need to spend more time on the questions. And spending more time on the questions, that's very inefficient. There are many ways to spend more time on questions, and it's many, many inefficient way. So I would say the focus on the question is really a key aspect of suboptimality. Spend more time on the question. Actually, if I push it even further, this is not through the scientific way of thinking, right? It's the artistic way. When you think of an artist, the way artists work, if you go to a fine art school, what they are taught is it's a three-step process. You observe, you think, and you ask a question. So when you're an artist, you look at the world, things are touching you, things are disturbing you, but you don't know exactly what it is, or you haven't crystallized it into a question. So what you do is you do a work of art. So it can be a painting, it can be a living art, I mean, anything. And the more you do, the more you know which question exactly you are addressing. And when you found your question, you stop. And a piece of art is a question. So if you go to a museum, if you go to an art gallery, if you go to an event, and you see an art piece, this is going to be a question. And it's a process just to get to the question. And the problem with the scientific way, I mean, the one I know the best, being a scientist myself, is that the focus is on the conclusion. So when you're a scientist, you want to reach conclusion, and you sometimes forget the question, and hence the electric car and extra. Right. So I would say then, to the first question, I would say that almost all inefficiency can have a positive influence on resilience. But maybe actually I'm going to ask another question actually, because I see the word resilience. I haven't really mentioned the word resilience. So I just want to be clear on the definition. It's like for performance and robustness. So resilience, for resilience, there are three different definitions. So I want to be super clear. So resilience is coming from material sciences. It's a definition of an elastic material. So it's a material that you deform and goes back to its original state. That's a resilient material. The second definition is psychological resilience. And so that means that you fall and you need to go back up. So for me, that's the terrible definition of resilience, because not only you fall, but we expect you to get back up, right? So it's really like twice you're going to, it's very harsh, I would say. And there's the third definition is the socio-ecological resilience, which is very close to my definition of robustness. It's the ability to persist, to adapt, and to transform in a fluctuating environment. If you go to the Stockholm Resilience Center, that's what they define resilience like. Huh? It's the ability to persist, to adapt, and to transform in a fluctuating world. And so in this case, yes, that's, we are talking about that resilience, right? Just to, so that way, we're clear. Okay, so question number two, would the concept of subatomy become a new form of optimization or with complexity in the long run? So it could be recuperated, I would say, in that sense, right? But you could say, well, it's another way of it's a larger optimization, like a extended optimization. So there's been some theorization on this, on optimization for really super large complex problems. For instance, from Carl Niklas, I can send you, it's a paper from 94, so it's a long time ago. And his conclusion is that actually it's not possible to optimize systems when they're too complex. So this is a threshold. You can optimize, or you have the feeling that you're optimizing something up to a certain complexity. When the system is too complex, it's just mission impossible. So I would say no, it can't be. So if you really focus on suboptimality, you will really go against the optimization. There is probably an interesting framework for you. If you want to, let's say you're in a situation and you want to get the best way forward. Often what's put forward is the multi-criteria approach that you probably know, right? So you need to tick all the criteria and then it's a compromise and then that's the optimal path. So that actually, usually it's not working because you always forget one, at least one criteria. And then you're going to hit the wall at some point. Right? So there's another way to do this, and it's called viability. So this is coming from mathematical economy. And so instead of having a multi-criteria, instead of focusing, let's say, on the multiplicity of criteria, you focus on the path. So that means that you want to have a path that can go like this, can go like this, but within that path, you always have a way to, you have several paths to survive, if you want. So I don't have the best definition for viability. You can look it up on Wikipedia or elsewhere. There are PhDs on this. So it's called viability. And actually, I think it's interesting that the word is used viability. And it's a very biological word. And it's different from a multi-criteria approach because it's really focusing on the path and finding a path going from A to B, but that can be very different. Right? And so this could be maybe an answer to question number two. And how does brilliance conflict with other normative ideas? Yes, what justifies your primary resilience over these other goals and values? So that's the tough one. That's a tough one because, of course, if you put survival, in a way, resilience, survival over everything else, then there's a strong moral and ethical question. So as you said, so there's the possibility that you would say, well, this person can die if the group can survive, but that's you're taking the seat of God in some ways, right? You decide who dies and who doesn't, so there's a problem, right? But there's also, even the idea of surviving, right? It's a little bit who should survive, who should not survive. So I don't have a good answer for this. But I'm going to go through a sideway answer. It's to change the core value that we have. So the core value to switch from many values to health. Health could be a good value that would help us to find a middle ground. And maybe you've heard about the One Health approach, right? Where you, I think I can draw something because I'm going to criticize One Health a little bit. I like to do to criticize things. So if you know One Health, right? So One Health is it's often these are supposed to be three exactly same circles. So this would be human health, animal health, and then I think it's environmental health, right? Something like this. Right. So and that means that when you think of health, you can't just have human health. You need to also consider the health of animals and the health of environment. So great, I mean, that's a progress compared to health in the 20th century, let's say, but there is many problems in this representation. Animal health, so insects, where are they? Are they here or are they in the environment? It's unclear. And also you see human health is this part here of human health that does not depend on animals and does not depend on the environment. So I'd like to know what kind of health does not depend on the health of the environment. It doesn't exist. So there is definitely a problem with this. So another way to look at it is to, that's what we call a common health, is to say actually it's a much more hierarchical way to look at it, where you have human health that depends on social health, that depends on nature health, let's say. And in this case, you can't have, human health depends on social health depends on natural health. And in this case, I think we can find a way to have some normative, human rights or this, if it's transversal. And if it's transversal, it's gonna be necessarily suboptimal to some extent, right? Because it will have to also account for this. But that's a tricky question though, because it's an open field. I'm not going to give you like ready-made answer, but at least this, to me, it's a key. This is the first step, but it's halfway. This is, there we are at the right place. Sorry, I'm too long. Tend to be too long. Path dependence and lock-in. Yeah, so lock-in effects. So on the second, does optimality lead to path dependence? So actually, what I told you about is about performance and optimization. This is an addiction. So when we are in optimization and performance, it's self-justifying. And so it's typically an addiction. It's an archetype. It's a psychological archetype, the systems archetype of addiction. If we switch from performance to robustness, we switch from addiction to adaptability. Adaptability, that means that you do things that are useless, to be always adaptable. And you can't be addicted if you're adaptable. It's the answer to addiction. And so this is the way to go against this lock-in effects. My major eating remains and their environment. Yeah, and to conserve. Yeah. So yeah, this is the question of the techno scene and the technosphere. So I mean, I would say like in a sense, but so of course, you know, in the Anthropocene, nature doesn't exist, even if I use the word, right? So I mean, it's a hybrid thing, right? Now there's not one square meter on Earth that does not have the imprint of humans, right? So it's all hybrid. And so actually this can, I mean, to me, that's compatible with, it's not like we want to exclude technology from the world. We just want to make technology and to give a different sense to technology, right? So if it's suboptimality is one way, or robustness is a way to put technology in line with the cycle of the Earth or this kind of thing. So that could be one way to answer. I'm going quickly to leave you some room. How to conserve biodiversity in a world so centered around humans, that's a difficult question. I mean, we've already erased a lot of the fauna, a lot of the invertebrate as well. So I don't have a good answer to this one, but it's definitely, I mean, one way to look at it in a sort of a negative way is that the more we kill the biodiversity, the more we lose ecosystem services. So anyway, there will be a feedback, right? So we won't be able to go on like this forever. So the earlier we take the turn of saving biodiversity, the better it's for everyone. So I've already answered to this one. Practice that to find a balance between trade-off and collective resilience. Yeah. I would say maybe health is one way to have the collective. You know what, the future, there is two paths for health. In some ways, there is the personalized medicine. You've heard about this, right? It's really individualistic to the largest extent. Or you have this, which is unpersonalized health. Unpersonalized, because you focus on natural health, building social health, population. And so this is probably much better. If you think of personalized health, in the short term, you have a lot of benefits. But the minute there is some grain in the system, some blockage in the system, then that it doesn't work anymore. Right? So this is much more robust, right? Even though it's less performing. Okay, and how to integrate politics and power relations in the suboptimality framework. Yeah, so that's a tough one as well. You have good questions. These are all good questions. You saw in my talk, I don't talk too much about power relationship and power games and all this, right? So I mean, when it could be a little bit rosy, right? All this idea of cooperation. I can just say one thing is that if you are radical, whether it's for the Green Party or for the extreme right, or you are in performance, you're still locking in performance. If you do suboptimality, if you are like into robustness, it's not radical by essence, right? Because you'll have to listen to everyone. You're going to value the heterogeneity of the discourse. So it's actually a difficult question, right? Because then in politics, this can be problematic, right? But, and maybe I'll stop here so that I can leave the room for more questions.
Hello, thank you very much for the presentation. It was really interesting. I've been wondering about the modularity. It's a way to increase the robustness, especially coming to electronic devices. And I was wondering if it exists like standards of modularity, like for example, the number of pieces which should be included into a model, the number of pieces which should be flexible that you could removable. And I wonder like if these standards already exist, and if not, if there is a technical way to build them.
So should I answer right away or? There's a good book to read, is the Age of Low Tech by Philip Buick. Yes. Yeah, was talking a little bit about this. So, I mean, I don't think there is one for all rule. the rule is the simpler your system, the better it is. So the more you increase the complexity of the system, the more vulnerable it's going to be and the less robust it's going to be. And the modularity also applies to organizations. So for instance, I was mentioning showing a picture of a collective of nurses that was from Birdsall. We found that they need to have a team of 12 people, not more. 12 people, because in a group of 12 people, you know very well your colleagues and you can propose initiatives and that's the right size. Also our brain is able to recognize 150 or to work with 150 people on average. So if you work in a larger organization than this, there are people you will not really know. Yeah. Exactly, it's all actually there is, we have part of our brain is a social brain. And it's actually the if you look at primates, the size of the social brain scales with the size of the group in which the primates are. So if primates are only with 8 other primates, they're going to have a small social brain. And if they are with like us, 150 people, it's going to be a larger social brain. Okay.
Yes, I wanted to ask a question about scales, because like in the beginning you mentioned that optimization of like focuses on like a too small part of the problem and thereby has like negative effects. Mm-hmm. So I wanted to ask for this the other approach, the suboptimal approach, if it is then very relevant to work in small scales or if it works on big scales as well. And just a very short comment about the radical thing. I think like since radical means like finding the root of the problem, yeah, it would, by this definition, be a radical solution.
Okay, now I agree.
thank you very much for the presentation. Referring to the very beginning, when you were talking about the era of fluctuations, uh-huh. I understand that in climate terms, maybe there is more fluctuation than before, at least the recent past. But then when you were mentioning like geopolitics and other variables, I'm not that convinced, and I would like you to provide some example of what do you mean exactly of these other fluctuations that are not the climate ones.
Okay. I need to take some notes. Yeah, maybe I can have some more. So on the first question, so the modularity, so the suboptimality can scale up. Actually, it's the only way to scale up when you think about it. So if you don't do, so if you go for optimization, it's going to be a pyramid, right? And indeed, you can scale up, but the more you scale up, the more vulnerable is going to be your system, right? Because it's going to depend on the smaller number at the head, and that's going to collapse more easily. So the modular aspect of biology, it's a suboptimal thing. You have small networks, small entity, let's say small groups that are autonomous. And that and the interaction with the other group is a bonus, but it's not essential. So if you think of the cells in your body, I can take one cell of your body and grow it in a lab. That cell is going to be autonomous. But of course, you can do much more if that cell is interacting with all the rest. And so you can scale up to trillions of cells because it's modular. And if you think of the governance of the commons that was mentioned by Elinor Ostrom, it's the same idea. So you have a small common, but they need to have recognition by a superstructure to survive. And so it's locally autonomous, but with a bonus from the interactions with others. And I agree with the radicality. Maybe it's not the right definition. So for mine, it was not the right. And the second question about, the geopolitics. So it's going to fluctuate in all directions. The climate, it's clear and everything. But when you think of geopolitics, I'm going to take the example of Syria, for instance. The collapse of Syria, one of the ingredients, not the most evident ingredient, but one of the ingredients was a few years of drought in the northeast of Syria and the idea of Bashar al-Assad to grow cotton in those regions. There were some other aspects. Huh? It's not. But then if you have climate change and then you have, in addition, this position, then this is amplifying the geopolitical unrest. But you can think of many other things. Huh? If you think of our tools, like the social networks that are like, convincing us into a narrower path, that's also, this can be a geopolitical problem, right? I mean, if you think of the field of fake truth, all this Trump and Bolsonaro and that are surfing on this alternative truth, that's also the world of optimization. In a way, we've optimized the way to, we get the information that is optimized for us, right? And that can have geopolitical consequence.
And how, like, can you achieve that robustness in large scale systems you mentioned? And
I think that's the colleagues.
Yeah.
And then, yeah, I have a question that we'll take pretty much.
Yeah, I wanted to ask Bobula, and a bit of said that we cannot have so many goals and achieve all of them. But what's your takeaway on that? Like, should we have one goal? You know, like, in the sense that you have several issues and problems, and we always need to take some of the trade offs in mind, but also maybe some synergies and. It's probably not realistic that we will like boil it down into like three points.
Thank you, Professor. My question is about if you ever thought of applying this your idea of robustness into capitalism. I think the main workers in capitalism today, they recognize the ability of flexibility of adaptation to any social movement, for example, marketize anything. Not everything is efficiency. We know there is a lot of inventories, capacity, not non-used work. So I was thinking maybe, I don't know, maybe society is already robust, but it's robust in the direction of accumulation. It's just that we have another goal using robustness. What do you think about applying these things into capital?
Okay, that's a fine. So I'm going to go in order. So yeah, indeed. So on the how to scale up, decentralization is the way to go to me. I mean, I, for instance, if I take states in Europe, for instance, if you look at the chief of states, presidents, or they usually don't really know the question. I mean, if you ask governments about ecology, they have a very vague understanding. Whereas if you talk about the mayor or like local stakeholders, they usually have a much better understanding of, because they have the territory, right? They have the link to the territory. So, and it's the same with suboptimality, right? You don't scale, but you connect. And with this, you can scale. So it's a decentralization, but assume decentralization. Living organisms are decentralized. There is no, like, you know, king, no... So that would be SDGs. SDGs. So for me, I would replace the SDGs by resilience, sustainable resilience processes. That would be my answer. So that means that it's not like we'll change 17 goals with one. We'll just remove the idea of a goal. We'll just focus on the path. So that means that the idea with robustness is that it's an answer not only to the world after the turbulence, it's also an answer during the turbulence. And it's a path to go through the turbulence. And the sustainable development goals, what you could say is that it's a dream, it's politically correct, it's all very good values, but it's not operational. And I would say it's even counterproductive, because the way it's designed will make it fail. And it is failing, actually. So that's why I would focus on resilience processes. If you are resilient, if you are robust, you don't care about performance, because you survive, you have a life, you can be happy in some ways, right? And you don't really want to go anywhere, right? You're just, it's as if it's, okay, I should say it in a different way. If you are in a fluctuating world, the long term does not exist anymore. And it's not necessarily a bad thing. That means that if you take Canada, for instance, Canada in 2021, they experienced the weather that they should have experienced in 2100. But they experienced it in the summer of 2021, the heat dome, right, on the West Coast. So that means that whatever we plan for the long term is going to happen this summer. So we shouldn't plan, you know, like to say that we are going to be adapted to a world at +2 degrees. No, it's going to be +4 degrees this summer. So there's no point, you know. So it's more the process. Be right now able to manage a fluctuation at 4 degrees. And so it's resilience process. And the capitalism, yeah. So that's a tough one. So of course, there's Well, so I'm not an economist, so maybe I should say that first. I'm a biologist. I would say that one of the things that I said here is that with the reparability and all this is that we are going to change our concept of property, right? So for instance, I'm sure that many of you in this room do not want to own a car just because it's a pain. You need to have a parking lot, you need to go to get it repaired, you need to go through many processes. So now we rather rent a car or share a car. And that's the economy of functionality, right? And so this is still in capitalism, but it's actually a bit away from capitalism, right? Because now the focus is not so much on the capital, but it's more on the usage. And if you do this, this is much more cooperative. It's probably the first step, it's a baby step, but it's the first step into something where you are less pyramidal, let's say. But yeah, maybe, I don't know. So maybe first ingredient, first thing that comes to mind.
Thank you very much, Olivier.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you. So what time is it exactly? I don't know. 15 minutes break, 15?
Okay. Go on.